didn't know I was going to be doing this, so it was a surprise to him. My name is Deidre Smith. This is my daughter, Andrea. I'm here to introduce an incredible man. In a book that I've been reading called Uncommon by the former coach Tony Dungy, he writes about his football coach Cal Stoll while he attended the University of Minnesota. He said that Coach Stoll often told players, "Success is uncommon, therefore not to be enjoyed by the common man. I'm looking for uncommon people." According to Webster, uncommon means not ordinarily encountered, unusual, remarkable, exceptional. So the message in the quote is very clear. Those who are uncommon, those who have the courage to go above and beyond the easy path, those who are willing to push themselves, those who are willing to work hard and achieve greatness are the uncommon people. I'm here to introduce you to a man who has always taken the road less traveled, always willing to stand up for his faith and his family, and a man who is truly uncommon, my dad, Elder Bill Morgan. Elder Morgan is one of four children born in Albany, Georgia, to the late Philip, an Adventist pastor, and Rosalia Morgan. He has a BS from Columbia Union College in broadcast communications. Just a few of his accomplishments include being the assistant dean of men at Washington Adventist University, TV production teacher at Camden County Vocational School, media arts instructor at Southwoods Prison, CEO of Real Mecca Video Production and Real Life Digital. His resume goes on and on for pages, and even though he's retired, it still seems to go on and on. But it's Father's Day, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about Bill Morgan, the father. He's a proud father of four, Debbie, Vanessa, Shelton, and me, and a grandfather of four, Reese, Naya, Andrea, and my son Miles. For almost 40 years, he's been married to my mom. I've had the best example of uncommon fatherhood. All men are equipped to be fathers. You meet someone, you fall in love or not, and you have a child. You're equipped to do that. But I've learned that it takes more than your equipment to be a parent. You see, a girl needs an uncommon father to not just teach her that she doesn't have to be common, but also that she's better than the common men that could approach her. Of all the ministries that Bill Morgan is involved in, it's the ministry of fatherhood that he takes very seriously. And here are some examples. Right from the start, he told us that there was no such thing as step in our family. He's my dad, and that's all there was to it. As a young girl, every morning I got up from school, I would walk past my parents' bedroom and see my dad every morning kneeling beside the bed to pray. I saw how happy he made my mom and the love he showed her, always affectionate, touching her hand or saying something to make her smile. And my dad was and still is my biggest cheerleader. Even when I don't have any confidence in my ability, he always has been there to say the right thing and to make me feel like I can do anything. As a father, he made it so whoever would be my husband would have to fill some big shoes and treat me as he did. When I met my husband, I was truly nervous about introducing him to my dad. And Andre was really nervous about meeting him, to be honest. But when they did, and I pulled Bill aside and I said to him, you know, Bill, I really love this man, but I know he's not Adventist, and I don't want you to be disappointed in that. And he said something that I never forgot. He looked at Andre, he took us back over, he looked at Andre, and he asked Andre, do you love God? And Andre said yes. And Bill said, just make sure that you take over where I left off. She should be better spiritually as she's with you. And when I see him as pop up to my kids, I have to smile because I see him and Andrea together, and it reminds me of him and I together. I'm gonna let her say how much pop up means to her.
My grandpa taught me a lot of things. One of the things he taught me is about the Bible. He taught me about Methuselah and how he was related to me. My grandpa taught me how to be healthy. He taught me how to make tomato juice and smoothies. And he likes to exercise like me. And that's why I love my grandpa. Happy Father's Day to all, and all a good day.
So to conclude, because I could probably go on and on and on. I'm my father's daughter. I'm proud to be the daughter of this man, this uncommon man. My dad really lives the life that God expects all of us to be an ordinary person created to do uncommon, extraordinary things. Thank you.
Thank you. yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, hallelujah. Good morning, everybody. What a wonderful day it is to know that Jesus lives right here in 800 Shelton Avenue, Camden, New Jersey. It's a wonderful day in the neighborhood, don't you think so? What a wonderful day to be uncommon. Hey, I asked myself a few moments ago, who in the world is that that teacher is talking about? Well, you know what? I love my children. It's tough sometimes, but God gave His Son Jesus for me. I could do no better than the same thing for my children. It's tough being a father in America today, and I want you to get it. It ain't gonna be easy, y'all. But I'll tell you one thing, if you are faithful to do the things that He would have you to do, He will bless you. I can guarantee you that He will bless you. Whether you like it or not, He will bless you. I hope you get that He will bless you. As it says, exhort is His name. It's hard for me to contain myself because I know how much Jesus loved me. He knew I was going to be trifling all the way down here in 2015. Yet He chose to go to the cross for me. Hallelujah. Jesus saw me, Bill Morgan, 73 years old, fat and bald, but says, yo, buddy, I'll take it on the chin for you if you stand in my place in 2015. I give you the challenge today. I give you, again I say, the challenge today to join Christ in the salvation for us all. Why? Because the Bible says to me that all heaven will turn out for one soul that repenteth. If you will accept the challenge, stand up with me. I know you can't stand up all some of y'all old, but I understand. All right, you may now sit down. I am not one who comes to church and sits down and expects to go to sleep. I expect to get something, and I brought something with me. Did you? Yeah, one of the problems we have in church today is that people come to church to get and not to give. Do you understand how crazy that is? You know, you should be a blessing to somebody else. That is why God woke you up this morning. Did you know that? He woke you up so that you can be a gift and a blessing to somebody else. If you can't do that, can I say that? And say that? And say that? What good are you? Huh? It's the kind of thing that says, yes, I can. And it didn't come from President Obama. Yes, I can. Because you know, Jesus paid it all for each and every one of us. And I want to take a moment to just welcome all of you to the meeting today here at the Mount Olive at Seventh-day Adventist Church, 800 Shelton Avenue in Camden, New Jersey, 08104. So reach out to us. And by the way, for those of you who are watching online, hit us right here. And let us know how much you enjoy what you are hearing today. Because you know what? There are other churches around us. You know what? We want to bless them with our gifts of joy and love, and we're going to expect the same thing from them. Why? Because we are one family, whether you know it or not. You know what? Sometimes we get so holy. Let's put it like this. We are so holy, we are no more good. You know what I'm talking about. I know you wish you could say what I'm saying, but you get scared. I'm giving up to take all of this. And you know why? Because Jesus loves me. And I know that. That makes a big difference, you know. When you understand and you get it, It makes all the difference in the world. I'm praying that we're all set in the back so that we can now be ready to roll with this morning's topic. Who am I and why am I here? See, that's why I always get prepared, because you never know what's going to happen, right? Here we go. How about this? And we'll do it this way.
It's here. Welcome to Can We Talk, a 60-minute broadcast that is here to give life. Help you to enjoy the life that God has given to you with prayer, prayer, needles, and prayer, share video, and share it with somebody else. Why? Because God has given us tremendous gifts, and He expects us to share the love of Jesus with all of those who know not of Him. Remember, this is a time to share. So give your friends and neighbors a call and let them know that we're all here. And hey, have them click us right in, right here at Can We Talk.
It's all right. We had a video set there, but it's not safe to try and restart it if you can, please. We'll see if it works. Because you see, there is something that the people need to see. We've been, for the last few weeks or so, dealing with all kinds of calamities here in America, have we not? Do you have any idea what on earth is going on? Have you thought about what on earth is going on? Take it back to the very first slide. There we go, then we'll see if it comes up. The only reason why I say that, because you see, we are not paying attention. Did you know that? I just want to take a moment and share some things with you. And even if the slides don't come up, we're gonna do it anyway. How's that? Because God gave me a brain, and I expect to use it. And guess what? I expect you to talk back to me. That's what this is all about. You know, so many of us come to church and we sit back and we... I ain't having that, y'all. Who do I think I am? Well, I'm that uncommon man. You get it? Let me say something to you. You know what? If those of you who were not here this morning for Sabbath school, you should have, because you see, that was a setup for this morning's message. Brother Dennis kept asking the question, where are the men? Did you not, Brother Dennis? Where are the men? Now look around you, brother, and tell me, where are the men? Have you ever thought about that whole idea
of me?
Where the men are and why they're in the position that they are in, especially us. And by the way, let me ask you a very crazy question. How many races are there? Huh? Somebody said none? I can't even believe you said that. There's one race, right? One race, the human race. We got all sorts of crazy things going on. We talk about black, white, all that crazy stuff. Listen, folks, there ain't no such thing. Let me just say this to you. There's one race of people. We are human. By the way, male and female created he them one. Are you with me? We folk are fighting on ordination, this, that, and the other thing. It's a crazy thing I've heard in my life. Jesus will use who he chooses. I'll say this. Yes, everything gets a little crazy, but let's see what happens.
see if this works now, and if so, we'll go from there, all right?
Well, hello everybody. This is Bill Morgan, and let me say this to you. Welcome to Can We Talk? A 60-minute broadcast that is here to do what? Help you to enjoy the life that God has given to you, and prayerfully, you take what we share here today and share it with somebody else. Why? Because God has given us tremendous gifts, and He expects us to share the love of Jesus with all of those who know not of Him. Remember, this is a time to share. So give your friends and neighbors a call and let them know that we're on the air. And hey, have them click us right in, right here at Can We Talk.
It is alive and well on planet Earth. Again, we are one family, human, yet there are divergences as we go down the ladder. You see those pictures on that screen? What do you see up there? What do you call race-wise? Caucasian, right? Native American, Asian, East Indian, and Black. Have you ever thought about how that ferrets out? Those are the five colors of man. Did you know that? Did you ever think of that? And in reality, it is only one color, just different hues of the same. I know, that's kind of deep. I can see the expression on your faces. What is that brother talking about? Well, to think things through here today. And I'm going to tell you something. I want you to go also into the Word of God. You're going to realize how important it is to know what it is that He's asking you to do. Father, in the name of Jesus, we take this moment to say thank you. As we go into this day's topic of who am I and why am I here? With that being the forefront of topic today, Lord, we just ask you to bless us, save us, and above all, keep us until Jesus lifts the clouds and walks in glory down to get us. And we join him in the eye and the air is our prayer. In the worthy name of Jesus, we pray and glory say. Amen. Amen.
Well, hello, Whip.
Imagine being me. I'm not even sure who I am. I'm lost. All I know is what you taught me, and you taught me I was nothing. Hell, my ancestors created reading and writing, and you told me I wasn't allowed to read. Plus, I was too dumb to read anyway. If you caught me reading, you would kill me and whoever taught me, if they look like me. Because if they look like me, then you own both of us. And you can do as you please with your property. You removed me from the head of household and taught me that the two things I had of value were my back and the thing between my legs. You made my woman hate me. How can she trust me with her safety if I can't even save me? You decided I could go. You were done with me. But you weren't done with me, nor was I free. I was allowed to go further, but not far enough. So where to and with what? I don't own anything. Not even the clothes on my back. My last name doesn't even belong to me. Let that sink in. I was given this name to show ownership, and I still have this name. So that means every time I felt as if I was catching up, finally gaining ground, you were quick to remind me of the fact that I had a long way to go. I fought in your wars. Wars that protected your freedom before mine even existed. Every year I celebrate July 4th with you. That's your Independence Day. But remember, when you won your independence, it did nothing for me and mine. After you told me I was allowed to read, I had to beg you to allow my child the same education as yours. When you finally granted me that, I had to pray every day that my child would make it home safe. Speaking of praying, I pray to the same God you pray to, the same one you told me to pray to, and you still bombed my church. Tulsa, Oklahoma, 1921. I had finally began to pull myself up by my bootstraps. You decided it was time to remind me I only have what you allowed me to have. When I fought back, you went to extreme measures to show me that I could not win. Tulsa became the first U.S. city to be bombed from the air by its own country. This is how far you've been willing to go to show me I was nothing. I am nothing, and I will always be nothing. As time went on, I forgave you. You killed my father. I forgave you. You killed my children. I forgave you. You raped my woman and would kill me for looking at yours. But I understood why. After all, I was nothing. You were something, so I forgave you. You passed law after law with the intentions of holding me down. Finally, in 1965, you tell me I'm allowed to vote. That wasn't that long ago. This car I'm sitting on is a 1965. That wasn't that long ago. When my brothers spoke up for me and said I should have what you have, you made examples of them. Now nobody speaks up for me. And if nobody speaks up for me, then my side never gets heard because I don't have a voice. I don't trust anyone who looks like me because I believe everything that you taught me about me. Last night I sold my mother crack. I made my woman sleep with a man for cash and killed my brother with $53, a pair of sneakers, and a watch. Not because $53 is a lot of money. Not because I really needed sneakers. I had sneakers on. If I didn't have sneakers on, I wouldn't have been out there. Not because I needed to know what time it was. I don't need to know what time it is to know it's not my time. Because he looks like me. And if he looks like me and I'm worth nothing, then so is he. See, I came from nothing. Everything I had, you took it back. As a matter of fact, you telling me that I owe you something. How did the offender become the authority? Your history shows you as a constant rule breaker. So who said it was a good idea for you to start making the rules? See, all I ever done was mind my own business. I was minding my own when you found me. But ever since we met, I've become your business. And business is booming, baby. I'm 18% of the population out here. I'm 60% of the population in there. I can't blame you for not understanding me. The same things you taught me about me, somebody taught you. You've never seen the world through my lenses because you never had to, and that's okay. But don't tell me how to scratch when you never had an itch. Don't tell me how to get up when you've never been knocked down. And don't tell me how to hurt when you never felt pain. You say it's no longer about race. When did it stop? I'm the black man in the wilderness of North America. I'm only what you made me. Please don't shoot.
Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar? Is that not Camden, New York, Philadelphia, Los Angeles? All over the world, South Carolina? What do you hear? Is that not correct? Let me tell you something, folks. Those times the gentleman talked about, I lived. You see, I'm sharing something with you today to just sort of prick your brain just for a moment. Why? Because it's coming back if you haven't gotten it. As a matter of fact, would you say it is already here? Okay? And what is the problem? Is that because we don't know who we are? And when I say we, I'm talking about us. Who is us? Do you see what's up there? Who is that? Now, some of you all might get really uptight because that picture is not light-skinned. Hallelujah. Come on now. I live in a family where we had that issue many, many years ago. And I was the black sheep in the barrel, hallelujah. But I've learned that we are humanity. I've also learned that, you know what, when people hang me, and then I come back to my own folk, and they damage me mentally, it's the same sin. Is it not? Done in a different way. But it is all what? S-I-N. How can you look at a man that we call Jesus, Yeshua? You do know that the J didn't come into play until 1600, correct? See, some of us get so confused because we don't know what things mean. Any idea what the word semantics means? Anybody? Semantics means this. It's a noun, plural, but singular or plural in construction. The study of the meaning of the words and phrases in languages. The meaning of words and phrases in a particular context. The full definition of it is the study of meanings. Oh, I tell you. The historical and the psychological study and the classification of changes in the sanctification of words of forms viewed as factors in linguistic development. In other words, I mess with words to get your head. How do I do that? We are the largest intake of the world, in the world, of media, are we not? Radio, TV, the movies. We are the world's slop jaw, if I can go there. You know what I'm talking about, right? For you young people, that's having a bathroom outside the house. But in order to get there, there's a little bucket that you have to take outside? I know you don't want to talk about that. But you know what? When you're on radio, you can say almost anything. Not quite. But I want you to get an idea of what we're talking about here. There are some of us who are having problems even in the places of worship that we go. We are separated one from the other because of where we come from nationally. You know, you got Negroes in America, you got folk from Jamaica, you got folk from everywhere else, and everybody's going to their own little corner. How you gonna go to heaven if you can't get along right here in this place? You excuse me for telling the truth, but you know what? They tell me that the truth shall set you free. Is that not correct? I pray that you understand that when you deal with this, take a look again at that slide. You know, we've got Christ. So how do we get to where we are today? How do we get to where we are today? What do I mean by that? You know, we come from Jesus where? To Adam, correct? And from Adam, oh, by the way, you do remember where Adam was created? Where was Adam created? In the Garden of Eden, okay? He was formed out of what? The dust of the ground, all right? Now, we call that today Africa, right? No. Africa is a name given by a Caucasian settler. Shut up. The Bible calls it, in Genesis 2:13, Ethiopia. That's scripture. Check it for yourself. Brother Morgan is not talking foolishness. Read it for yourself. It is important that you understand who you are, because in understanding who you are, you can now help somebody else. I can't help you if I don't know who I am. I cannot share love with you if I'm not connected to the source of the almighty love that is called G-O-D, God. Hallelujah. Well, the earth was ruddy. Does not the scripture say that? And if that is the case, then Adam himself was red. You know, guess where else is red? South Carolina and Georgia. You ever been down there? I know some of you over down there, you don't want to own up to it, but I know the deal. Guess what? So am I. Albany, Georgia. Okay? Some of the things that the young man talked about, I had to live. My mom and my dad, as we traveled around the country, being an Adventist pastor, son, you know, the old PK, you get blamed for everything, and I probably deserved it, hallelujah. You know, there's almost, well, I never did that. My daddy was faithful and beat my fanny every Friday night until I got old. And guess what? I finally realized that I deserved it. Because whenever he said, jump, my brother and sister said, ha ha! I said, oh no, you Negroes might move the table. I ain't jumping nowhere. They would look at me and say, well, what is wrong with you, boy? I said, huh? You know the old favorite answer? You get real dumb, huh? Well, guess what? It worked for me for a while, till my grandmother got me. She said, boy, come here. I don't know where you get this attitude from, but you're going to stop it in this house. I said, Now you know, black children don't say stuff like, without going to the cemetery, right? You know what I'm talking about. She said, I don't know if I should say this. Is it okay if I say Ouija? She said, boy, go get me a switch. You know what I'm talking about. I went out and came back with a little twig about like this. I ain't crazy. I come back with a twig. She said, I said, go get me a switch. I went and came back with one this long. She said, all right, stay right there. I'll be right back. She goes out, and there is this bush out there in the front yard that's got these things go all the way to the way. And she had three of them. You know what she did? She braided them together. No, she plaited them jokers together. Them are trying to sound like I'm Motown. She plaited them jokers, all right? And tweezed them on the end so they wouldn't separate. And you know why? Because she knew I was going to run. She knew I was running. My brother, the sister that just sat down, said, "Yes, ma'am." See, I didn't have much sense. I'd run. See, Elder Bernard would run too. I could see it in his face. That's all right, Elder Howard. We'll say it. We love you too. Guess what? And when she got done with the switch, she put a chair in the middle of the room. Guess what? My mama was a chip off the block. She said, "Now you lay down there and don't you get up." Today, we give them timeouts. 5 years later, they're in prison. Okay? My word says, spare a rod, spoil a child. You get it? You know, Brother Dennis jumped all over me this morning in Sabbath school because everything he came out of his mouth was set up for what we're talking about right here today. Thank you, Dennis. I'm telling you, folk, we don't have time to be messing around. So we ask ourselves, why are we going through all these changes? We've gone through the color spectrum. I'm sure we've talked about that. There it is again for you. Take a look at it again so that it becomes a picture in your mind so that you can indeed reflect upon who it is you, we, I am. You have to understand who it is that you are so that you can help somebody else. So then, why is that important? Look at what this brother says, okay? Who am I? He says, researchers have proven scientifically that humans are all one people. They're called one ancestor skin, and ultimately, my skin and your skin is a consequence of ultraviolet light, of latitude and climate. Despite our recent conflict here in the United States, there really is no such thing scientifically as race. We are one species. Each of us is much more alike than we are different. All came from Africa. We're all made of the same stardust. We're all going to live and die on the same planet. A pale blue dot in the vastness of space. We have to work together. Is that deep or what? So then, who are we? And why are we here? Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 to 10. We've already read that this morning for our scripture, correct? You've already read it. We'll go through it a little bit. It's all there. You read it? You understand it? You got it? Do you understand it? Are you sure? Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, say not I am a child, for thou shalt go to what? All that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations, over the kingdoms, to do what? To root out, to pull down, to destroy, and to do what? Throw down, to build, and to plant. So, what are you doing with it? Have you thought about that? You know, so many times we just go to church and we just hop and whoop and all that kind of stuff, and we get through and say, honey, we had a good church service today. Somebody said, well, what did the pastor say? I don't know, but we had a good time. What did you get from the service? What did you bring to share? Is it biological influences as to who we are and why we are who we are? You specifically, me specifically, are these things the same? Going back to that part in Jeremiah where it talks about how, you know, I knew thee and in thy belly, right? As you were formed. Think about this. The question comes, is man what? Predestined to be what he or she is. 2 Peter 1:10 says, wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure, for if ye do these things, ye shall never what? Fall. Ye shall never fall. 2 Peter 1 verses 3 to 10 says, according to his divine power, hath given unto all us things that what? Pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. It's everywhere, y'all. Your TVs is coming in over your computers. Now your cell phones, your iPads, everything. Guess what? You put in the wrong URL, you're going to get something. You're going to say, oh, Jesus, where did that come from? Because some things are so close to others. I remember some years ago, there were, you know, I'm quite a conspiracy buff, but I look into a lot of stuff. And they were talking about some things that were happening in the White House, and there was a House bill. And I said, well, I'm going to find out what this is all about. You know, in the early days of computers, I don't know stuff. I'm just kind of finding out. I'm old, so to speak. So I type in www.whitehouse.com. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. You do know that it's whitehouse.gov, right? What came up on whitehouse.com was the biggest porn site in the world. I had to unplug my computer to stop it coming through. It was popping and popping and popping and popping. You have to be careful where you search, y'all. You have to have a specific idea as to what it is you're looking for. And by the way, older people, don't allow these young people to scare you to death because they can be on computers and you say, I don't know how to do that. You can learn. My mom passed when she was 95, but she was on the computer every day. You know why? Because I'm neither go there. I talk to her on the computer every day. She got so sick of me. She said, boy, get off of this thing. I said, but if I do, you might leave me. She said, what are you talking about? Well, you know, I just want you to know that I love you, babe. I'll talk to you later. Guess what? She was on her way to prayer meeting on a Tuesday at 10 o'clock in the morning on the freeway in Los Angeles, California at 94 and a half. Hallelujah. And we got the nerve to sit back and say, well, I'm tired. I can't get out of bed. Well, you're that way because you choose to be that way. 2 Peter 1, verses 3 to 10. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you what? That you shall neither be barren nor fruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. You know, when you ask God to forgive you, he purges you from your sins, y'all. You have to learn to accept his purge and go about your business and live. Just don't turn around and go back. Because if you do, what does the Bible call that? He says it's like a dog returning to his own vomit. Hey, buddy, read it for yourself. Okay? That's what it says. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fail. So how do I do this? How do I make my calling and election sure? Does anybody know? How do you do that? How about Revelation 3:11? Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy what? Your crown. Ephesians 1:4. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Is that deep? Or what? Hey, y'all. He knows who you are and where you are all the time. He knows who you are and where you are all the time. So question comes again. So who am I? And why am I here? Any ideas? Any thoughts? Well, Ephesians 1:11, according to God's purpose, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, chosen, glory, or were we made heirs to something that was deep? And if so, heirs to what? Heirs to what? To be a prince, princess, one must be what? An overcomer, correct? We've got to repent of our sins, allow God to clean up our lives, and do what? Overcome and keep stepping. We've got to be, as the little white letter said, become a part of the elite, a part of the special forces. You know what they do, right? They're the ones that go in and take out all the folk, right? Because they are the go-getters. They have what? Special gifts, special talents. Otherwise, they would never have been chosen, correct? Because they were chosen for that job. Hey, listen, you can put in for something, but you may not be qualified. But you can get qualified, can't you? If you don't even have the gift or the talent, you can become qualified by doing what? By persevering and picking and working out and doing the kind of things that will get you there. Once you find out what it takes to get there, you then can become that individual. Well, know this. We've been given talents, you know? And I'll tell you, you write these scriptures down and read them later on. God just happened to look at the clock. We're way over time. Not that I care, because I got no place else to go. But the reality is that, and I love talking about the Lord, but I want you to get this. Write these scriptures down, okay? Matthew 25, verses 14 to 30, all right? And when you do that, because they're all there, you need to get and understand that God has given you special gifts and special talents. And if you use them properly, what will he do? Remember the parable of the three, with the talents, where the first one was given what? Five talents. The second one was given two. The last one was given one. What did the person who had five do? He went out and doubled his, right? The one who had two did what? Went out and doubled it. The one who had one did what? Went out and hid it in the dirt. Hey, God, hey, y'all. Could you consider that being us? We have been the one who had the one talent that we thought we had because we didn't know who Jesus was, and we buried it in the ground. And when he came back, we told him, well, Lord, we know that you're a hard taskmaster, so what we're going to do is we're going to give it back to you. But God blessed the other two and told them to go out and do what? Get some more, did he? But the one, what did he do? He took it away from him and gave it to the other. Is that not a symbol of what has happened to us? Things have been given because we have refused to do. So how do I get this? We've got to have some kind of an understanding. Take a look at this. Let me go back. Salvation comes through an understanding. We've got to get an understanding of everything. There is a spirit in man and the grace of the Holy Spirit given them through understanding. You've got to gain knowledge and wisdom and knowledge so that you get and be happy. Right? The scriptures are all there. Write them down. Then John 3:27 says, John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Now, you can think that, oh, I can do this, I can do that, I can do the other, but if God does not give it to you, you can't do nothing. So, there is salvation, by the way, in the end. Matthew 24:13 talks about, says, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. We're going through stuff. Luke 10:20, withstanding this, rejoice not, but that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Revelation 3:5, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name bare before my Father and before his angels. So, what do we do? We have to do what? We've got to make a choice, don't we? We have to make a choice. Joshua 24, verse 15. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods of your ancestors served before beyond the Euphrates, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, Brother Dennis, we will serve the Lord. You have to decide what you're going to do. Then Jesus, speaking in John 7:17, says, if any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether it speak of myself. And then said, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. That's all things that talk about choices. Write the scriptures down. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. Okay? Then there are additional texts. If you want them, I'll give them to you later on. All right? Ours to choose. You've got other things. Take a look here at Revelation 2, verse 10, which says, fear not. Fear not those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you in prison, that ye may be tried, and ye have tribulation 10 days, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Some of us are going to go to jail, y'all. Are you ready? Can you handle it? Probably not. Huh? Let's just tell it like it is. Some of you can't. Some of us don't even want to break a nail. It is what it is. We don't want to wash a dish. We don't want to do nothing. But what if you have somebody tell you when you get up and go to the bathroom? How many times you can shower? How many times you can shave? And all you're going to get for this week is peanut butter and jelly. I've seen it happen, folks. Too many times. I had one student who went over the weekend. Get this, y'all. Over the weekend. I saw him over the weekend. I came in Monday, and I am told that he is dead. His roommate beat him to death because he was talking about Jesus. Now, I'm not going to say who his roommate was because that could cause trepidation. But let me just say this to you. There's a lot of mess going on. Oh, by the way, you watch a lot of TV. How many of you folks watch TV? Y'all watch TV? Well, I got one for you. Take a look and listen to this. Michael, are you ready? Take a look and listen to this.
What would happen if Lucifer decided to quit hell and decides, I want a life of my own? It just seems appropriate. If the devil's going to take a vacation somewhere, it might as well be Los Angeles.
What he gets his kicks out of is encouraging people to do the things that they're not supposed to do.
Are you trying to bribe me, sir?
Yes, of course. Most people are just immediately drawn to him. He has this kind of magnetism. People start confessing their deepest, darkest thoughts.
You break the rules sometimes, don't you?
Sometimes.
Put my siren on and drive really fast. Just because I can.
It feels good to get away with something, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Through the course of the pilot, Lucifer meets Chloe, a police officer.
Talk to me about your relationship with the victim. How does she end up dying in a hailstorm of bullets and you get away without a scratch?
The benefits of immortality.
You spell that with one or two M's, I always forget.
And those two are an odd couple right away.
You're coming with me.
Oh, with pleasure. I can get out, as you know.
How'd you do that?
We should be out there punishing those responsible.
How could you possibly help me?
I can be very persuasive with people.
As much influence Lucifer has on everybody doesn't work on Chloe. He is fascinated with why his powers don't work on her.
What do you desire more than anything else in this life?
This is it? This is your big trick?
It's one of the most unique screenplays I've read. It's very clever, it's very smart, it's very contemporary.
Menadil, how's it hanging, big guy?
Your return to the underworld has been requested.
We just check the calendar. The 7th of Never through to the 15th of ain't gonna happen.
We can explore morality and all those sort of things, but the way in which it's delivered, it's a really fun ride.
What's your name?
Lucifer.
That's coming to broadcast television next year. You've seen the one called The Messenger this year? You better open your eyes, folks. The Bible talks about spiritualism in the last days, does it not? It's coming, and it ain't playing. And you love scandal and how to get away with murder. And you know what I'm talking about. I'm not even gonna go there, because you already know what I'm talking about. Watch this.
All of nature, earthquakes, famines, pestilence, hailstorms, killer heat waves, floods, drastic weather changes are breaking all past records. All the tornadoes, it looks like nature's out of control. The God's word is clearly predicting it would happen. The wrath of God is to be outpoured on this earth to an unleashed fury of nature. Because God is warning mankind that judgment is coming, and these are labor pains, and the closer you get to the parking of the kingdom, the more frequent and intensive you get into the path of the kingdom of God.
Have you not heard about those kinds of things? So the question is, where are we in time? Where are we in time? Michael, we've got to go to ordinary. Psalms 18, 25 and 26. With the merciful thou shalt show thyself merciful, and an upright man thou shalt show thyself upright. With the pure thou shalt show thyself pure, and with the froward thou wilt show thyself froward.
I'm going to take my 5 years. So they contacted.
Hey, it's been a great day. We want to say thank you again for joining us right here on Can We Talk. We'll see you again next week, right here, same time, same station. God bless. On Can We Talk. We'll see you again.
Thank Elder Morgan for his message this morning, that we will be blessed and realize what God has for us for the outcome of our lives. Continue to keep our church in prayer as we continue to move forward. The Lord will use us in a very special way. We're all one race and we can come together and we can make things happen through God. I want to remind all of you that to come back out this afternoon to support our young people in our AY. We'd like to see everyone here to come back. Also, the elders will be meeting for those who like special prayer in the pastor study. So if you have something that you're going through, we'll be meeting with you also in the pastor study. We also like you to have, we have forms out in the foyer for our health ministry. You want to make sure we all sign. We're going to come together because remember, united we stand, divided we fall. We come together and make a difference. We all can move this message forward. At this time, let's stand as we have our benediction. Most loving Father, we come before you in thanksgiving today for the blessings you bestowed upon us in your message by your manservant, Elder Morgan. We ask, Lord, that you will bless us and strengthen us, that we will remove the shackles from our hands and our eyes and realize that you have a special message for us today to make a difference in this world today. So we ask you to guide us, Lord, that we will remove the things that hold us back, hold us down, the little things that Satan wants to bring into our lives that keep us from men and women of one race, men and women of color, men and women that stand strong and firm on your word to make a difference in this world. So bless us as we leave, that we will unite our hearts and our minds, that we will get involved on our prayer line that we have every morning, that we can stay prayed up. We will get involved in our prayer service at 10 o'clock in the morning, that we come on Wednesdays, and 7 p.m. Wednesdays, that we will stay prayed up, that we will come together as a people. Nothing will stop us. Nothing can stop us with you in the center of our lives. So be with us as we leave. Prepare us, Almighty God, that we will come back and support the youth of our church, that we will bring our young people back, that we will stand firm. We ask you to bless our fathers and our men today, Almighty God, that we will be the men you will have us to be, that we will make the difference, that we will let others see you in our lives, in our homes, as we work with our children, as we work with our youth, as we sit at the supper table with them and not by ourselves, that we will stand firm on your promise to reiterate your good tidings you have for us. So, Almighty God, stand with us, be with us, that we will be difference makers in this world, because you're coming soon, and we want to be prepared. Bless us. Strengthen us and keep us as we return back today, that we will stand strong for you, live for you in all we do and all we say. Bless our church. Bless our families. If more than anything else, save us, Almighty God. We thank you so much today for your mercy. We thank you for your grace, and we thank you for your undying love for each and every one of us, that you died that we might be saved. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we proudly and we humbly say, amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, it's been a great day.